Pancreatic cancer is often called the silent killer because most patients don't experience any symptoms and they aren't diagnosed until it's too late. And once considered a rare disease, the number of pancreatic cancer cases is now growing around the world. It's projected to become the second leading cause of cancer deaths after lung cancer in about a decade. So understanding how to screen, how to diagnose, and of course treat the disease is critical as we mark World Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Day. So for that, we're joined by oncologist Dr. Ludmila Schaefer with St. Luke's Hospital in Kansas City, Missouri, as well as Julie Fleshman, CEO of advocacy group the Pancreatic Cancer Action Network, also known as PanCAN. Thank you both so much for joining us today, and welcome to Quick Take. Dr. Schaefer, let me start with you, because I know you've treated cancer patients for decades, and you are growing alarmed at the increased frequency that pancreatic cancer is appearing. So what can you tell us about how and why it's on the rise?
So thank you very much for having me. Pancreatic cancer is on the rise. And before, we were considering that this is number four, but right now it's really anticipated to be number two. And why it's on the rise, it's still on investigation. However, we noticed that all of the sudden that young population, and we see more and more that pancreatic cancer rising, and we don't really know exactly risk factors, but we suspect that it's change in maybe genes as well as body mass index and a variety of different risk factors.
Okay, so that's a lot of unanswered questions, which is why it can be so alarming for our families when they hear that a family member has fallen ill with pancreatic cancer. So Julie, you speak with patients and families all the time. You know how to speak with them and how to explain things. Let's back up for a second here, because remind us what the pancreas does. I know that people with family histories of pancreatic cancer sometimes get that organ removed. So it's not essential to have that organ to live, but obviously it plays a critical role in digestion.
That's right. Your pancreas plays a critical role, just as you said, in the digestion of your food. And there is no early detection test for pancreatic cancer. So usually by the time it's diagnosed, the tumor has already spread to other organs. And that's what makes it difficult then to remove your pancreas. So some patients, if it is diagnosed early enough before it is spread beyond the pancreas, can have their pancreas partially surgically removed. It's called a Whipple procedure. But unfortunately, the majority of pancreatic cancer is diagnosed late stage, where surgery is no longer an option.
Right. And it's also spread to other organs as well, which makes it difficult. Dr. Schaefer, what does the pancreas's location in your body mean in terms of options to remove that organ? Because it's difficult to get to, isn't it?
Yeah, pancreas located in the middle of the what we call abdomen. It's kind of hidden in between where is the liver and stomach. And why it's so difficult to diagnose, just like Julie said, because a lot of times the symptoms very vague and we don't really have, you know, obvious. Of course, depends on the location of the cancer within the pancreas, because the pancreas has head, body, and tail. So depends where is the cancer, so the symptoms can be very difficult. And in terms of the location, why it's surgically very difficult to remove, because it's attached, it's next to the spleen and where duodenum, the small bowel. So it's really kind of hidden in the middle. And as well as I also would like to add that pancreas really helps us digest food. It produces a very important enzymes that help our digestion. So that's why it's so critical. And when we remove part of the pancreas, you know, really a lot of different symptoms the patients experience during and after.
And when I read up on who is most at risk, the same kinds of groups tend to come up, the elderly and the obese. But the elderly and the obese are pretty vulnerable to any number of diseases. I mean, their profile puts them at risk for lots of different cancers. So, Julie, as you talk to different patients and their families, what have you observed in terms of how much more common this cancer has become, and what kinds of people, what populations of people it's touching?
Yeah, so we, you know, continue to learn more about the risk factors of pancreatic cancer. We do know that about 10% of pancreatic cancer is caused by a genetic mutation, so it's hereditary. But that's a small group compared to everyone else. Another risk factor that is important for people to understand is those people with longstanding diabetes, pancreatitis. Of course, as you mentioned, age, smoking is also a risk factor. And so we think it's really important for people to understand their risk. And actually, new guidelines now recommend that those people who have a first degree relative that has had pancreatic cancer, so a mom, a dad, a sister, a brother, or a child, should consider talking to a genetic counselor to talk about their family history of cancer and decide whether getting genetic testing for pancreatic cancer might be right for them.
Okay, so that's one way to kind of screen for it potentially and get ahead of finding out when it's too late. Let's talk about treatments. Dr. Schaefer, my understanding is that the only cure for pancreatic cancer is surgery, but most patients are not eligible for surgery by the time they're diagnosed. So you have a pretty small pool of people who do get surgery, and therefore the outcome is not very good either. Talk us through, beyond surgery, what other options there are. I mean, is chemotherapy, radiation, do these produce good outcomes?
So for the last about 5 to 7 years, we have new novel ways how we treat pancreatic cancer. And yes, for a long period of time, the surgery considered the only, the surgical removal would have a better outcome. However, beyond 5 years, survive only 3 to 5% patients. So it's important at the time of diagnosis to identify is a different stages. And even if pancreatic cancer, just like vast majority of cancer, have stage 1, 2, 3, 4, but how we divide, if it's resectable, it's located in the pancreas without touching important vessels. Second, it could be borderline resectable, means it still can be surgically removed, but might still come back. Also, we call it locally advanced, means that this is touching a very important vessel in the pancreas that if we remove a tumor, still it's a very high risk. So patients actually do better with the treatment. And then the vast majority present with metastatic disease when they travel to the other organs. Mm-hmm. So for the treatment, besides the surgery, right now there are a lot of new ongoing clinical trials. Number one, it's investigated if we should do chemotherapy. And chemotherapy, usually it's a multi-drug agent. It has a lot of side effects. Second option, it also molecular tests. So right now, every patient that walks in the clinic, we evaluate for molecular profile because we have a specific treatment targeted toward pancreas. We have other options, immunotherapy, but immunotherapy really does not work well in the pancreatic cancer. It's not really immune type of disease, but now ongoing clinical trials, combination of chemotherapy and immunotherapy. So as in terms of the radiation, also clinical trials, however, the vast majority is still chemotherapy.
Okay, so it's a pretty tough road ahead for someone who is suffering from pancreatic cancer. So Julie, I like what Dr. Schaefer said about the clinical trials. I know you spend a lot of your time working with grassroots groups and raising money to put towards research. What can you tell us about what clinical trials will look like in a year's time, in 5 years' time? How much progress and innovation is there in this?
Yeah, I mean, it's really exciting, actually, the momentum and the number of clinical trials that are happening in the pancreatic cancer space. And it's only by patients participating in clinical trials that we will get to the next best, you know, new drug or treatment combination for this disease. So PanCAN recommends that all patients consider clinical trials at every step during their disease journey. And we also have an amazing clinical trial database to help patients find clinical trials that might be best for them and within their geographic area.
Do you find that more drug companies, pharmaceutical companies, are interested in coming up and developing treatments for pancreatic cancer? It is rare, but because it's rare, a lot of drug companies tend to want to focus their efforts on the more rare diseases, believing that there's a bigger payoff.
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely an unmet need. So it's a place that if a company can develop a new drug for this disease, it would be really important for this patient community. So we are seeing more pharmaceutical companies investing in pancreatic cancer, and organizations like PanCAN partner with them to provide incentives and really de-risk this drug development space.
And Julie, I know you lost your father to pancreatic cancer more than two decades ago. What specifically about that experience prompted you to devote your life to making sure that you could increase awareness of this disease, especially when we've seen that the five-year survival rate of this disease has not really improved the way that it has for other forms of cancer?
Yeah, I mean, my dad was diagnosed in 1999. He was 52 years old. He died 4 months after diagnosis. Unfortunately, a very typical story. And I was mad, and I could not believe that there was nothing being done to improve outcomes for patients. And luckily, I had the opportunity to get involved in PanCAN and just have the honor and privilege to lead this organization. But although we still have a lot of work to do and a long way to go, boy, have we come a long way in the last 20 years. There is a pancreatic cancer research community that did not exist before. There are clinical trials and lots of options for patients that didn't exist before. We understand patients, as Dr. Schaefer said, should get genetic testing and biomarker testing to best match them with the right treatment. So we are making progress, and we need people to take action, to get involved, and to donate.
Yeah, absolutely. And of course, with the increased case count and a couple of celebrities suffering from pancreatic cancer, I think of Alex Trebek, who died of the disease. Dr. Schaefer, how much does that contribute to people being much more aware of the disease and coming to you specifically and saying, you know what, can we look into this, especially since I have some family history here?
Yes, this is very important. We educate all patients as well as family members. And right now with the population being more aware, it really play a big role because we have to remember we are discovering new biomarkers. And it's so important what Julie said, that we have to partner with the community. We have to work together. And that's what, when I created the Doctor Connect movement, we really try to raise awareness. And one thing I would like to add, that we educate patients also on novel things. For example, we have a novel blood test that actually can identify molecular residual disease. It means at the molecular level, mm-hmm. we could test certain DNA and identify if the cancer could return sooner, or how the treatment responds, and all of this and new markers. So having this awareness really bringing a big impact on the society and on the community.
Yeah, a lot of technological developments there on that front. Thank you so much for both of you for joining us today on World Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Day. Dr. Ludmila Schaefer, an oncologist, and Julie Fleshman, PanCAN CEO.